Alors, je vais appeler évidemment les deux chairmans de la première session sur repenser les théologies pour mieux adapter les stratégies, le professeur Nicolas Simon et le professeur Michael Nassila. Le professeur Nicolas Simon, qui est donc professeur d'addictologie à Marseille, et le professeur Michael Nassila, pardon, qui est professeur de physiologie à Amiens. Et je leur laisse la parole pour agrémenter ce premier plateau. Merci à vous.
Eh bien, Amine, merci beaucoup. Tout d'abord, un grand merci aux organisateurs. C'est un plaisir qu'on est tous ici à Paris, dans un lieu magnifique, et avec un programme encore qui on fait de mieux en mieux chaque année. Donc, c'est toujours époustouflant. Alors, comme l'a dit Amine, bon, moi, je suis très heureux de présider cette première session de plénière, aussi avec, bien sûr, donc Nicolas Simon, prof de pharmaco à Marseille. Et comme l'a dit Amine, on va commencer très fort dans les débats, puisqu'on a choisi deux sujets qui sont parmi les plus complexes. Je ne sais pas d'ailleurs lequel est le plus complexe que l'autre, le plus complexe des deux, mais on va commencer très fort avec de l'épigénétique et de la génétique. On va parler des causes des addictions, et peut-être ça va ouvrir des perspectives en termes de personnalisation du traitement, parce que l'idée ici, c'est d'améliorer également les stratégies de prise en charge. Donc notre premier orateur est le docteur Gilberto Guerra, qui nous vient donc de Vienne. Il est le chef du département de prévention drogue et santé au sein du Bureau des Nations Unies sur les drogues et le crime. Donc il va nous parler d'épigénétique. Et puis on enchaînera, je pense, directement, puisqu'on a une heure et quart, et j'ai déjà parlé avec les orateurs qui ont prévu de parler 30 minutes. Donc si on veut être sûr de garder 15 minutes de questions pour tout le monde à la fin, je pense qu'on va se réserver à la fin les questions. Et nous aurons donc le deuxième orateur que tout le monde connaît aussi, le professeur Wim van den Brink, professeur de l'Université d'Amsterdam, qui est aussi directeur de l'Institut de recherche sur les addictions d'Amsterdam et qui vient nous présenter ses données, sa dernière méta-analyse publiée sur le baclofène. Donc là aussi, ça va être un sujet d'intérêt, j'en suis sûr, et qui suscitera beaucoup de questions.
On gardera d'ailleurs peut-être les questions globalement à la fin, après les deux présentations. Ça permettra de garder de la fluidité dans les présentations.
Tout à fait. Donc, docteur Gilberto Guerra.
Good afternoon to everyone, and many thanks particularly to Dr. Amina Benjamina to inviting me for this Albatros edition. Thanks to the colleagues of Albatros for giving me this space in the beginning of your conference in the first plenary. And I am also very honored to share this space with Professor van der Brink, a pillar of addiction medicine in the world. Let me say that my presentation, I have to say that we will go with this presentation in what I call an unexplored territory, a territory that is difficult to know with the knowledge we have today. And also, it's difficult to know because I will accompany you that I am not a super specialist of epigenetic and genetics. But I will try simply to show the complexity of the situation. And I have to tell you that I have a hidden agenda. I want to reveal my secret agenda, my secret scope in doing this presentation. I would like to cooperate to contribute to all the awareness about the etiopathogenesis, the etiology and the pathogenesis of addiction as a health disorder. Because until now, many people are progressively believing that it is an health disorder, but then they believe and don't believe. They say there is a disease, there is an health disorder without a pathogenesis, without an etiology. Making denial about this etiology and pathogenesis of the disease make our discipline very, very weak, and the authorities, particularly in the health area, very strong in not recognizing the need of our patient. So I will try to show you the complexity, and I want to start from my field, the policy, because I was a normal practitioner in addiction medicine for all the first 25 years of my career. Now I work 10 years, 11 years in the UN, in the United Nations Office on Drugs and Crime. And I wanted to bring you a sentence that has been adopted together with the entire resolution of the United Nations General Assembly Special Session on Drugs in April 2016. And this sentence is saying, we recognize drug dependence as a complex multifactorial health disorder characterized by chronic and relapsing nature. Here you are an entire room full of addictologists, of specialists in addiction. For you, it's very obvious this, but you cannot imagine what was the difficulty, what was the effort, what was the need of dialogue to arrive to have 193 member states, including all member states, approving this kind of sentence, and saying that it was not done in a small village. It was done in New York in 2016 in the General Assembly. You understand the relevance of this sentence that is saying, it is admitting we are in front of an health disorder, not something different, not a moral failure, not a criminal attitude, not a social trend only, not a free choice only, not a recreational issue only. And until we don't have this kind of things really written in stones and really understand by policymakers and politicians all around the world, our discipline will remain very, very weak. So the importance of the sentence that was the fruit of a dialogue of 10 years with the scientific community together with the international community dealing with the world drug problem. And also another new presence in the policy came in this year and was accepted, fully accepted by the General Assembly resolution. The idea that there is a science behind treatment and a science behind prevention. And the scientific community has to maintain this continuous dialogue with the people deciding about the drug policy. There are two resolutions about this, a continuous dialogue with the scientific community, with the international community dealing with the policy, diplomats speaking with scientists. And unfortunately, this is a work of 2006, but the situation did not change so much in another 12 years. Also in very high-income countries, very developed countries, the attitude is that our colleagues, the practitioners, are saying substance use disorder patients are only weak-minded. They dismiss the problem as weak-minded. And this is a 2016 survey on our colleagues, general internists, saying that they have no capacity to deal with the problem from the pharmacological and psychological point of view. Doesn't matter, okay? But they say substance use disorder is different from any other chronic disease because they are using substance is a choice, you know? Although when they accept that it is a disease, also they say there is a if and a but is not a true disease. It is their choice. And also they say opioid agonist is only replacing one drug with another prejudice about methadone and buprenorphine. And then they say they deserve punishment, 12% of the colleagues. So, and this is the top. Imagine that I do the international beggar because I ask rich country to give us a contribution to train in addiction medicine a lot of our colleagues in low-income countries. Imagine that for a lucky combination of factors, tomorrow one rich country is giving me 10 million for expanding the work I'm doing with WHO in addiction medicine. And they give me they put me in charge of extending training opportunities for this population. This article saying that a lot of our colleagues, health professionals, are rejecting the opportunity of education and training in this area, are rejecting the opportunity to be trained, because this is remaining in their CV and could have the implication that they are selected to work in this area. They don't want to see this kind of patient. So the level of discrimination is still high, not only about public opinion, media, or general population, but is very strong among us, the practitioners. We should restart explaining to people that simple exposure to salt is not making hypertension. Exposure to sugar is not making diabetes. It is a very complex issue, and it is complex also for our disease. I go very fast about this genetic evidence that we know from family studies, adoption studies, the twin studies. The component of irritability of this disorder is very high. Depending on the study, it's going from 30% to 70%. You can have another study about alcoholism saying 50% variation related to the inherited DNA, the inherited factors with our chromosomes. But you understand already that the other component, the other 50%, is related to environmental condition, that until now we were aware of them, but not aware of in which way they were using their
weight to gravitate on the etiopathogenesis of the disease. What are doing the genes? For those who are not familiar with this matter, what are doing the genes per se? They're influencing many things. They're influencing, for example, the metabolism of drugs. You can have a polymorphism affecting alcohol dehydrogenases or the free acid amide hydroxylases or the catecholorthomethyltransferases. And these enzymes are under genetic control and modifying the metabolism of drugs. But you can have genes influencing the pharmacodynamic, influencing the capacity of the drugs to do certain effects, influencing, for example, the dopamine receptors, the GABA receptors, and so on. And you have genes preparating people, predisposing people to initiation, because they are influencing temperament with impulsiveness, sensation seeking, depressive anxious attitude. And look that, for example, this simple gamma 2 subunit of the GABA receptors, when it's dysfunctional, when it's functioning differently, is going to have to induce impulsive behavior, we said for the initiation to alcohol, is going to have the opportunity of less sensitive individuals to the sedative effect of alcohol. Means that you have, someone can say, I have drunk 3 bottles without any effect of sedation. And this is facilitating for him the possibility to develop the dependence. But then you have also more dopamine firing in this individual with the difference in the gamma subunit, and so more rewarding effects of alcohol combined with less sedative effect of alcohol is the perfect way already prepared for you to become an alcoholic. I don't want to speak about so many connections with the dopaminergic system and the reward pathway in our brain. I have spent a lot of time in my life, my professional life, also studying the serotonin transporter, the low functional polymorphism of serotonin transporter, particularly the short component that is related, you see, is 26% among the young students, the 17, 16 years old students experimenting with drugs and alcohol. 26% is carried, and 11% only among the abstinent children who are not using at all alcohol and drugs during the secondary school. You can see that carrying this genotype, the serotonin transporter genotype, with low functionality of the serotonin reuptake, is associated with an increase in novelty seeking and an increase in aggressiveness in these children. Their temperament is changed because of also the association with this genetic component. And the studies of Agrawal and Linsky, very famous, saying that all the stages of cannabis use and abuse and dependence, the development of cannabis use disorder, starting from initiation, are influenced in a certain way by inherited component. When they call the polygenic risk, all the genes together in terms of influencing alcohol consumption, has been demonstrated that this is influencing mainly how much alcohol you drink in terms of quantity. But the environmental factors on the other side are influencing how many problems you develop with alcoholism, such as domestic violence, car accident, losing the job, etc., that are more influenced by the environmental factors. So it should be very simple until now, saying genotypes and allele at risk are affecting neurotransmission, are affecting and modulating temperament and behavioral attitude, are modulating metabolism of drugs and pharmacodynamics. You have these two clusters, externalizing behavior and internalizing behavior, children with reward deficit syndrome, with novelty seeking, with impulsivity and lack of inhibitory control, and children on the other side with depressive and anxious attitude that are more at risk because of inherited reason, genetic reason. But now we come to this famous and new frontier that is epigenetic. I have taken a lot of time to understand, not being a genetist, what is epigenetic. I don't know if you are familiar with this. And there are portion of genes, portion of DNA, they can be read or not read, silent or activated, translated in something that has to be done on the ribosomes or not translated at all. So what you have inherited, imagine that would be a book. You have some pages that you can read and some pages that because of environmental factor you cannot read. You open the book but you cannot read. I can do an experiment now, if I have someone helping me, one of the co-chairmen, you can come. He will play the role of RNA. I will play the role of DNA. He's coming near me. Do you know what he wants to do? He wants to copy my codon, a portion of my DNA,
to translate in activities, in ribosomes, in building receptors, building neurotransmitters, building enzymes, etc. And I ask him, this is a portion of my brain controlling for my temperament. I ask him to read and go and copy. Please read. He cannot because of methylation or because of acetylation, the position of this portion of DNA is completely hidden and not available to be copied by RNA. The only possibility is that for other permissive methylation or acetylation, I open this and it's coming. I don't know if you read and the other, it's coming calm. You can read calm. Yeah. And operate all the changes in the brain to make an individual calm. Do you know what happens if this remains closed because of methylation in DNA and DNA acetylation and methylation? That this individual have inherited the calm gene to be calm and to be a warm heart, but in reality is very irritable. He's irritable because although he has received a certain inheritance from inherited instruction from his parents through the DNA, this DNA is not easy readable. So this is epigenetic, this is the way the so-called environmental factors are affecting our brain. This is true for radiation, pollution, etc. But we will see things where we start the sequence of what I call the reconceptualization of etiopathogenesis. Look, we are speaking here about the prenatal stress. When is starting the disadvantaged history of our patient? Sometimes is starting minus 9 months from the pregnancy and prenatal stress that is going to dismantle, to disrupt the mesocortical limbic dopaminergic system because of this stress. And before we can say, this is a cofactor, inherited factor on this side, environmental factor on that side. No, now we can say that as part of the environmental factors such as prenatal stress, we have changes in the modulation in the expression of our genes. So the real effects on physiology and behavior of prenatal stress are mediated through epigenetic changes. And look, the inherited factors influencing temperament are not only directly influencing the initiation and the availability to start with drugs, but also indirectly because they are going to affect the interpersonal relationship between children and parents, particularly the attachment condition. And when you have parent-child attachment impaired, dysfunctional, disorganized, or problematic, you can have really different situations that are related to the temperament of the child. For example, irritable babies develop an anxious attachment, or avoidant children reduce the maternal sensitivity. These things are a sort of interaction you see between the genotype that make your temperament when you are very young and your mother or your father. And look what happens, that maternal separation, being without attachment with the mother, is one of the most important risk factors for not only addiction medicine but also for psychiatry. And we have this evidence of these rats that have, for genetic reason, no care for their offsprings. They are not grooming and not licking enough their children. The result is decreasing glucocorticoid receptor expression and high corticosterone level and high anxiety, sort of internal stress. The other mother, licking and grooming the offspring, is obtaining high expression of glucocorticoid receptors, low cortisol levels, and low anxiety. So being calm and being relaxed instead of being anxious and in trouble. And sometimes in the conference someone asks me, do you suggest that for prevention we should lick our children? This is for animals, for experimental animals, for wild animals, not for humans. But there are many other ways we can show that we are really in touch with our children in a very warm and effective way. We know that about the adverse childhood experiences, so terrible situation that are characterizing the history of so many of our patients. Most of them are simply not reporting this history condition, but in their history, we should create a relationship in our centers, in our services, that they are able to explain what happened during their childhood. We have emotional neglect, physical neglect, emotional abuse, physical abuse, household dysfunction. But now we know in which way these adverse childhood experiences are taking action because they are modulating the reading of our DNA. Again, you have epigenetic changes related to the attachment problem, you have epigenetic changes related to the adverse childhood experiences. Look at the three pillars that this author has rebuilt of changes in gene expression, regulating exactly what we said, the hypothalamus pituitary adrenal axis with this sort of internal stress with glucocorticoid receptor genes, modulated by the environment, modulated by early postnatal stress, and the serotonin transporter gene. We have spoken about it in terms of inherited serotonin transporter gene, but now we have someone saying, be aware that the inherited gene modulating the reuptake of serotonin can be expressed in a different way. Also the brain-derived neurotropic factor, BDNF, that are so complex that we cannot explain in so short time. I go fast. Nemeroff, Professor Nemeroff, a father of depression treatment in the United States, has defined this the paradise lost. When during your infancy you don't have the necessary care, you're exposed to emotional and abuse, emotional abuse, emotional neglect, and so on, you are really going to have a series of consequences, a sort of platform of risk not limited to substance use disorder that is mediated through epigenetic changes, through the translation of environmental stressor into vulnerability. We know a lot about maltreatment and the history of adult alcohol and nicotine dependence. Look, this is also in humans, in alcoholics, with the measures of methylation that are affecting exactly the neurotransmitters and the enzymes that we know about alcohol dehydrogenase, about opioid receptors, about GABA receptors, about dopamine receptors and cholinergic receptors, all affected by potential methylation changing the reading of these genes in alcoholics. I don't want to go too much into details, only to show that if you have, these are, for example, permissive methylation that are very high in people with no adversity in childhood and no disorder in adulthood. And then you can see in this in red. And in when you have only adversity or only disorder without adversity, you have a reduced level of methylation. The lower level of methylation in this case is for adversity and disorder together, characterizes these individuals. In this case, probably to have low methylation is going to have a permissive role respect to certain opportunity of silencing certain genes or activating certain genes. Do you want to have a more complex view again? In reality, we have genotypes who have a permitting roles on epigenetics, a classic case of post-traumatic stress disorder. You can have the same trauma making an effect on someone in terms of epigenetic changes, gene expression induced by the trauma. And in other people, no effect at all on the epigenetics because of some protective gene that is not permitting the epigenetic changes. So there is also already someone studying the interaction between the stable inherited genes and their role of facilitator or barriers against the epigenetic changes. The child coming out is a child with a sort of internal mechanism of continuous stress when it's not necessary, when it's unnecessary. And then this child is not, or this adolescent is not able to cope with the stress when this is necessary. We measured in one of my studies the addiction severity, the alteration of the hypothalamus pituitary adrenal axis, the altered response to emotion, all related to childhood experiences, to childhood neglect, that were evident. At that time I was not in the condition to study this part of epigenetic, but could be for sure mediated through changes in gene expression. Let me say something from the social point of view, for the social implication of what I said until now in the history of our patient. Someone has done during the, this is the Bellis published at the UK survey on adverse childhood experiences, neglect and abuse, household dysfunction. And he found clearly a great relationship with heroin, crack cocaine, and that could be related to the adverse childhood experience. But
He found that 9% of the population in the UK has had more than four or more adverse side of the experiences. But unfortunately, the situation is not the same for everyone, because the poor have had 12% and the rich have had only 4%. So the adverse side of the experiences are not affecting equally the population, but affecting more the poor, with the consequences that I have shown before in terms of changes in gene expression, not drinking a glass of water. And if you want to see this, another impressive study saying that in areas, in districts of the town, or areas of, or regions with social deprivation, you have an higher prevalence also of candidate genes at risk for vulnerability for substance use disorder. Imagine that if you put together the adverse childhood experience, the epigenetic consequences, and the high prevalence of genes at risk in this district, you create a sort of Galapagos island of social deprivation and disadvantages. That is not good for visiting for Darwin to look to the turtles, but is a terrible situation that we should break, a vicious circle we should break in terms of re-including these people into the normal society. I always say that we have two ways to use the head, unfortunately. In my mission around the world, and particularly in low-income countries, I see situation where the head is used in a different way. Someone, you see the one child is looking to a colored book, learning to read and write. Another is using the head to transport bricks. And this is not only a social issue. You can see there is this is affecting the neural network that underlie executive function and self-regulation. Again, our impulsivity mechanism, self-regulation mechanism implied. Poverty and stress is able to change the amygdala activity, increase the amygdala activity, and reduce the prefrontal cortex activity, that is emotional control. Also, this is through neurogenesis and epigenetic changes. So when they ask me, is non-medical use of controlled drugs recreational? Recreational only. I ask, recreational for whom? For people who are in trouble, in big trouble to live in their normal daily life and they live in the garbage, or for people using drugs for fun for 3 months, 6 months, and then they go to the college and they don't have any consequences of their use of drugs. This is taken from a portion of the article of Nora Volkov. Tomorrow evening she is here with us, the Director General of NIDA, together with George Kub and McClellan. We have published this article about the mechanism of addiction, saying that each person has a unique susceptibility to use drugs initially, sustaining drug use and undergoing the progressive changes in the brain that characterize addiction. But you see, they say also in using drugs initially is not a free choice, and we should be able to explain this to our politicians and policymakers. I go fast. We have really two trajectories in the etiopathogenesis of our diseases. The gene variants apply to temperament, the parent-child secure or insecure attachment, the early childhood well-being or the adverse childhood experience, the bonding to family, the engagement in school, and the obviously the availability of drugs or not. Someone is going to the college in the UK, that is a famous opportunity for the rich people in Europe, and someone other is going to the service that we manage every day on the territory for substance use disorder and mental health. We have very good news by the fact that in reality, good parenting and changing the quality of a rearing environment is able to change the risk and is able to completely undermine, cancel, delete the risk induced by genetic factors. Particularly, for example, this article showed that my famous genotype, short dysfunctional serotonin genotype, cannot induce any risk of vulnerability if it is connected with an engaged and supportive parent associated to it. But you can see also in our studies that substance abuse initiation is associated with serotonin transporter gene short allele only when you have the mediation in terms of significance with the mother-father neglect or care. Look, to this is very impressive. I have spoken about changes in neurotransmission, changes in inherited factors, changes in epigenetic factors. But look, we are speaking about changes in the morphology of the brain, not only the activity or the function of the brain. This is, you see, in blue, you see the big hippocampus at the school age of people who have had high level of maternal support and low level of maternal depression. A combination of these factors has brought to a almost the double of the dimension of hippocampus in these children, with obviously behavioral consequences if you think how much the hippocampus is implied in emotional and affective status. Let me complicate another bit, another minimum, the problem. Drugs per se, this is the effect of cocaine, are affecting the gene expression, are provoking epigenetic changes. And so if you have cannabis, cocaine, methamphetamine, and heroin doing their own changes in methyltransferases, histone acetyltransferases, and so on, you have that the famous allostasis phenomenon or the place preference that we see in experimental animals are conditioned by epigenetic changes. But imagine now to put together epigenetic changes and changes in gene expression coming from the history of the individual, starting from minus 9 months, and the changes of epigenetic provoked by the exposure to drugs. I think that no psychiatrist on the face of the earth at this time, or no neuroscientist, can explain to us what happens. It's a big mess, a big unexplored condition. But this is the real complexity of the disease we are taking care. Don't forget that, unfortunately, epigenetic changes have been found to affect also gametic cells, the cells that you transmit to the offspring. And so in reality, you can have certain attitudes, certain gene expression that are present also in the offsprings when the parents were exposed to drugs. And now we start to speak about epimutation, not only mutation in a Darwin way, but epimutation in a Lamarck way. I go to conclude my presentation with some good news. One advantage is that epigenetic changes are reversible. Clearly, you understand that cannot be reversed by 1 hour of psychologist a week or some small interaction at the level of some counseling. We have to clearly put in place an enormous and complex response responding to all these cofactors that have induced this kind of vulnerability. And obviously, the good news is that if you invest so much, you can have really changes in epigenetic that is stable, making the disease chronic, but not irreversible. You have already some evidence, some impressive evidence in 2017 of people who are reaching the same level of methylation of the control respect to before treatment. After treatment, they reach the same level of methylation of the control, showing that something happened that with a very intensive engagement in group therapy, for example, there was something happening, being able to modulate gene expression. And we have a new frontier about pharmacological intervention, for example, inhibitors of histone deacetylases that are used to change and reverse the ethanol-induced epigenetic changes. And we have probably here a new frontier that could be able not only to treat, but to cure this disease. And finally, I don't want to speak about psychotherapy. There is also some serious psychotherapy showing higher gene expression at post-treatment than non-responders. Psychotherapy, I ask you, can alter epigenetic state. Is not still demonstrated with solid evidence, but it is a direction. Let me finish with what we can do at the policy level. We need really serious prevention program, but the serious prevention program have to be part of a large framework with protection of children and not having children exposed to the dramatic situation I described before, particularly taking care of the fact that children have to be in school, not in the street. In many low-income countries, this is not granted for free. And to develop this, what is called not school performance, not school engagement only, but school connectedness, belonging to your school, belonging to your educational community as a factor really changing, for sure changing, I have no evidence, is my opinion, methylation and acetylation in the brain. And I conclude with this slide that is a sort of alarm also to be given to my friends in France. This is a study from Finland. They celebrated a wonderful result after 10 years of their policy, their campaign against being drunk being drunk frequently. They found that in the general population of adolescents, being drunk frequently after their campaign of 10 years went down from 7.2 to 3.6. Then someone went to check what happened to the children of unemployed parents, parents with low educational level, and adolescents with depression. They found that their baseline was not 7.2, but was 69 percent of being frequently drunk. And then during the 10 years of the campaign, the rate has grown to 75.8. So there was a population of completely non-responders, unreachable from the campaign, by the campaign. And I think that my final message is we should take care of this population of people suffering more from the early stage of their life, having a dramatic disadvantage situation, suffering inequalities, and giving them opportunities equal to others, particularly in the prevention of addictive behavior. Thank you for your attention.